Good morning.
Good morning.
We want to welcome you here to worship with us on this Graduate Sunday. We're excited about celebrating folks who are moving forward and looking forward to a brighter future. So we'll be doing that a little later on. If you notice the friendship pad that's on your pew, how about grab that? Let us know that you're here. And we like to keep a record of who's here and what they've got going on. We have several announcements. One very important announcement is today after church, we will be dismantling and working together to prepare our sanctuary for a few changes that are going to occur. If you don't have any plans, John, is it right after service? Is that right? 1:30. Thank you. At 1:30, we'll be meeting here and moving some things around. If you can come back out, that'd be much appreciated. We'll be moving pew pads and other things like that. Next weekend, in light of that, next weekend, we will have a unified service in Pioneer Hall. If you're a guest with us this morning, Pioneer Hall is our fellowship hall, which is right across the way. I think most of us know that. But this sanctuary is going to be somewhat deconstructed so that we can make some needed changes to the flooring and things like that. So that's next Sunday, Pioneer Hall Unified Service at 9:55. You'll notice in the bulletin we do have an insert here, and it's got several announcements that we're excited about, ministries that are going on. One of the things that I want to highlight for you is that we are excited to have the Low Country Boil Bocce Night, sponsored by the Men of the Church. The Men of the Church Ministry are excited about this event. It's their gift to us, and we're going to go out. We're going to play bocce over at the LPDA here in Valdez, and come out for that. It'll be fun. I think most of us can agree that Low Country Boil is something that we always welcome. So we have that going on. Also, a couple of weeks from now, our Vacation Bible School kicks off. I'm excited about that. We started this week creating the props, and we are preparing to turn Pioneer Hall into a fun factory with big gears and pipes coming out of the walls and some things that will make our kids get excited about how God is making them and has plans for their lives. Let's see. Any other announcements? Any other announcements we can think of? I believe that's it. Thank you. Surely, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the nations, proclaim that his name is exalted.
Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, the royal Zion. For great in your midst is the Holy One of
pray together the prayer of confession. Holy and merciful God, in your presence we confess our failure to be what you created us to be. You alone know how often we have sinned, in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, and forgetting your love. By your loving mercy, help us live in your light and abide in your ways, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Be assured, God wants to save you. God does not want you to be afraid. God wants to be your defense through Christ. Surely, it is God who saves me. Did I get off track here? Oh, I'm not thinking, sorry, okay.
Afraid, for the Lord is my stronghold and my surety.
think I might sing the next part. I'm kidding. Now's the wonderful time where we reach across the aisle and we say welcome to our visitors and to our friends, and we pass the peace of Christ. Good morning.
Good morning.
How you guys doing? Good morning. Hey, so you've been playing outside?
Yes.
All the rain's done. It's been bright. Been playing outside. Has it been hot outside?
Yes.
Yeah, all the rain. Guess what all the rain did at my house? It made the grass grow. So guess what I've been having to do? I've been having to cut grass. Yeah. Yesterday I was cutting grass and it was so hot. And I just looked in the house, looked like it was so far away. There was no shade tree around. I was like, man, I'm so hot and thirsty. And then one of my kids came outside, and guess what they had? They came out, and I was so happy because they had a drink of water for me. They had a drink of water. And they were like, Dad, Dad. And as thirsty as I was, when I saw that water, guess what I thought?
Forget.
Yeah. I was like, I'm not so sure that I want to drink that. This is actually water with a little dirt in it. You know, it's got dirt. You know, it's dirt and water. Is that very refreshing?
No.
It's not, is it?
No.
It's not. Actually, what she brought to me looked like that. Now look at that.
That's better.
Oh, yeah. That's right. It's pure, it's clean. And let me tell you, when you're thirsty, there is nothing better than a glass of water. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Jesus is like water for our soul. The Spirit of God is like water for our soul. And sometimes in life, things get difficult and we have a hard time. Maybe we fall down. Maybe we get in an argument with a friend. Maybe things don't seem to go the way they should at home. And life is difficult. And a lot of times, people don't turn to Jesus for their soul to be lifted and cleaned. They turn to something like this. Maybe anger. Maybe they want to hit their friend. Or maybe they just don't be the way Jesus would have them to be. But the Bible teaches us that when we turn to Jesus, and whenever we look to the Spirit of God to help us and to give us the life that we need, it's like we're drinking this kind of water. You're not too young to learn that. Remember, even from this early age, that when we turn to Jesus, when we give our heart to God, it's like we are drinking that water, and it gives us life. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for these children. We thank you for the potential that is here. We thank you for their spirit, their souls. And we ask that even today, that you would open their hearts and minds, that they might understand the value of being your children, being people who are taking in living water for your glory and for theirs. Amen. And speaking of life and what life has for us, today is the day where we celebrate our graduates. And we know that those are human beings who have a lot of life in front of them. They've accomplished goals that are going to help them move into the future that God has for them. And so we're excited about your presence with us this morning, and we're going to highlight those folks. So graduating from high school we have, and stand and come up if you're with us, high school graduates. We have Britt Simmons, who is the son of Jeff and Angie Simmons, graduating from Tri-City Christian School. Britt, are you here with us this morning? He's not. The students will also be recipients of the message done by Presbyterian minister Eugene Peterson and his group of linguists. And if you're not familiar with the message, it is a great everyday reading Bible written in contemporary language that is true to the ancient languages. So, great gift for our graduates. Britt will be receiving one of those. Britt also will be receiving the one-time award that we give to members or children of members graduating, and that is the Walter and June Pons Award. So Britt will be receiving that this year. We'd also like to recognize Sarah Sharp. Sarah, are you with us? Sarah is the daughter of Mark Sharp. She's not here. She will also be receiving the Walter and June Pons Award this year, as well as her message Bible. We're congratulating today and celebrating the accomplishment of Thomas Modak, who is the grandson of Emil and Phyllis, yes. The singing things messed me up. I'm off track now. Emil and Phyllis Jackman. So Thomas, congratulations. There's your message. We love you. And also Madison Johnson. Madison here this morning? Madison is a youth who's been active. Madison is a student who is not a member, but she's been very active in our youth group. So we're congratulating her as well. Now we move to the 2017 college graduates. So graduates, when I call your name, if you could come up and Ms. Dawn Hess has a certificate to give to you. Lauren Emily Church, who's the daughter of Emily and Walter Church. She's a graduate of North Carolina State University with a master's in public administration. Taylor Welborn is the daughter of Sanford and Brenda. She has earned a Bachelor of Science in Nursing with a minor in Child Development and Family Relations from East Carolina University. Kelsey Costner, daughter of Bobby and Gretchen. She's graduating from Lees McRae College with a Bachelor of Applied Arts and Sciences in Criminal Justice. Eleanor Frederick, she's the daughter of Mary Jane and Kevin. Graduate of NC State University. She received a Bachelor of Science in Food Science with a minor in Nutrition Science. Ivy Griffin, son of Alan and Lou Griffin, graduating from North Carolina State University College of Engineering. Ivy received a Bachelor of Science in Computer Science and a minor in Mathematics. Sarah Griffin. Sarah is graduating from Campbell University College of Pharmacy and Health Sciences and Campbell University Lundy Fetterman School of Business. She holds a Doctor of Pharmacy and Master of Business Administration. Two Griffins. Lots of education. Alan has a big grin on his face, actually. He is very proud of his children and very happy that, okay. All right, so also, Marion Burris, UNC Chapel Hill, Bachelor of Arts in Dramatic Arts. And now we'll call up Christy Johnson to represent the Presbyterian women.
Scholarships to these wonderful candidates. Without your help, we couldn't do it. So, our first one, we're going to have to present five scholarships today, two Presbyterian Women Scholarships, one Ralston Family Foundation Scholarship, one Newell Fletcher Scholarship, and one Michael Daymore Scholarship. So, our first media and journalism and plans to major in public relations. She is a member of the National Honor Society, Gamma Kappa Alpha, and serves as the Honor Council Secretary for her sorority, Sigma Sigma Sigma. Caroline works on the Daily Tar Heel newspaper design staff. Our next scholarship recipient is Alex Ferris. Alex is a senior at Drom High School. He's an honor graduate, a North Carolina scholar, and a presidential scholar. He is a member of the symphonic and marching band and has served as drum major for the past 2 years. He has been involved in scouting since first grade. He joined Troop 192 in May of 2010 and has served various positions. He has earned his Eagle Scout rank this year. He plans to attend Western Carolina University after graduation. Maxwell Tinkteller, and he is receiving the Ralston Family Foundation Scholarship. He is a senior at Drone High School. He will be attending Caldwell Community College and Technical Institute in the fall, working on an associate in fine arts and music business with plans to transfer to Western Carolina and continue music business studies. In high school, he was the trumpet section leader as well as the Tri-M Music Honor Society president. He was awarded by his peers with Student Award for Best Brass Student. He earned his Eagle Scout and is now one of the Scout Masters of Troop 192. The next scholarship will be the U and Milton Fletcher Scholarship, and this is being awarded to Emily Bordelot Cannon. She chose to change her career path as an adult after graduating from equestrian school at Meredith Manor International Equestrian Center and spending years teaching riding and training horses. Then Anna came along and she realized she had a passion for health and wellness in relation to nutrition. She is currently enrolled in the dietetics program at Appalachian State University. She plans to work in the healthcare or education setting after graduation. Michael J. Morris Scholarship, and this goes to Megan Treadway. She is a senior at Drone High School, will be attending Lenore Ryan and studying occupational therapy, as well as playing volleyball. While at Drone High School, she was a member of the National Honor Society, the Anchor Club, an honor grad, North Carolina scholar, an athletic scholar, and participated in the Student Government Association. She has also earned bronze and silver awards in the Girl Scouts.
Graduates, we're excited about the plans God has for your life. We want to remind folks that have a graduate with them this morning that we will be having a reception lunch just after service today to congratulate you.
Thank you. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm glad to be back with you to help out a little bit in Kevin's recovery time. And I've been trying to keep up a little bit with the health issues and situations with families. So we come to our pastoral prayer time, and I had noticed that Benji Peru has pneumonia. We want to remember Benji today. Several others, and certainly all the graduates, and this is very impressive today to have this honoring of the graduates and to know of their accomplishments. Makes my head swim, some of the studies they must have gone through to achieve these moments. Let us come before God in prayer, after which we will join together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, with your people now in this hour of worship, we lift to you our praise and thanksgiving. We bring the supplications that we have in our hearts and minds, and asking that you would intercede for those we love near and far. We pray for healing and encouragement to all who face surgeries and times of recovery, or Fern Brinkley, that her hip surgery will go well on Tuesday and she will have good recovery in good order. We pray for Kevin Frederick in his days of surgery recovery. Let his healing be complete and give strength to Mary Jane as she continues her role as caregiver. Bless their family and all their challenges in these days of change and graduation in their lives. Give them your peace and your fortitude in these days. I pray for Roy Ray Burris as he recovers from surgery. Give him strength and fortitude as he regains his strength. We pray for older members of this congregation, for widows, for widowers, for whom grief weighs heavily night and day. Help us all to reach out to each other, extending fellowship and gifts of practical care and assistance to one another. In this season of graduation, hear our thanksgivings for students who have reached these days of graduation and challenge for their future. Keep them safe. Guide them to make good decisions going forward. Bless their lives in all the ways that they will be challenged. And we pray again for peace and for justice in your world, the peace and justice only you can give. Our spirits continue to feel the heavy weight of sadness as we hear of terrorist actions, of death and destruction, and the lives of many people made sad and suffering because of these actions. Oh God, wherever we are, help us to be the instruments of your peace, to bring peace and healing in our land. We pray for this congregation during these days of challenge. We're going to be in a building renovation of the sanctuary. We ask for your spirit to be upon that work, that it may go smoothly, and bless us all that we may get behind that and give it our support. Hear the prayers of your people where we are, each in our own private lives and hearts. Hear us as we pray together as Jesus teaches disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our treat to get to sit right there. It's like you're right up by the stereo speakers. And the balance is very beautiful. I want to thank you for that. This is Pentecost Sunday, and as you remember, there are various symbols that we use for Pentecost. On your bulletin, there's a dove on the front. That's one of the symbols. There's fire, and wearing red for the fire of the Spirit. And wind is another symbol of the Spirit. But the text that we're using today is directing our attention to water, as Jason has pointed out with children. It's one that we don't think about that much in the symbolism of the Holy Spirit. But here the reading of God's Word from the book of John, chapter 7. Let us pray for God's Spirit to help us to understand. Let us pray. Merciful God, in this ancient word, your Spirit is very much a living Spirit to teach us and to guide us in Christ. And so we turn to it again now to be refreshed and to be reminded of who we are called to be. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. John's Gospel, chapter 7, 37 through 44. I'm going to be referring to the first part of that chapter a little bit, if you want to keep the Bible open a little bit later. On the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. When they heard these words, some of the crowd said, "This is really the prophet." Others said, "This is the Messiah." But some asked, "Surely the Messiah does not come from Galilee, does he? Has not the scripture said that the Messiah is descended from David and comes from Bethlehem, the village where David lived?" So there was division in the crowd because of him. Some of them wanted to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What is it in our minds and in the souls that make us who we are? What is it that motivates us to keep coming to church, to make time for God in worship, to make time for each other in this setting that we call church? What is it that nudges us to say yes to taking on some role of service in the Lord's church? If we were to sit together and discuss it, we might offer to each other many different reasons why we feel motivated in that way. Could be that somebody might say, "Well, I'm just afraid not to," playing the guilt hand on it. But most likely, all of our answers to that question would come from somewhere deep inside of us, even if we cannot quite identify what it is. I think that this is what Pentecost is about. And it could be that this passage from the Gospel of John gets to the bottom of that motivation to acknowledge the value and the richness of being a church together. Over the ages, the story of Christians receiving the Holy Spirit has caused some confusion. And maybe there are times when we feel like our religious convictions are inadequate or flawed. They don't measure up quite to what we've heard other people say about receiving the Spirit. But when there's some new breakthrough in our lives, some new development where we see clearly the fruit of ministry growing in our lives, we may be willing to admit that, yes, it could be the Spirit of God working on me. This passage from John's Gospel provides assurance and perspective. If we review the wider biblical picture concerning the work of the third person of the Trinity, anyone who finds himself or herself able to say, "Yes, I believe in Jesus as God's gift of grace to save me from my sins," anyone who feels moved to express that confession has the Spirit. For it is the first work of the Holy Spirit to convict us of sin and to convert us to a profession of faith in Christ. And as time goes on, to feel the guiding presence of that Spirit as we grow. The setting for this story in Jerusalem is during the annual celebration of the Festival of Booths, sometimes referred to as Feast of Tabernacles. The Festival of Booths was one of a number of religious commemorations which were introduced or instituted as the command of God. If you want to see a list in the Old Testament of those festivals that are lined out there, Leviticus chapter 23 has them lined up. Festival of Booths calls to mind for the Jews the years after the Exodus, when the people lived in tent-like booths in the wilderness. The Festival of Booths is a remembrance of how God sustained them even though they were without a country or homes to live in. This festival must have had much the same spirit as the festival that we experience here in Valdez, the street festival, commemorating Walt Disney's history and the arrival of the first settlers from Italy here in 1893. Festival of Booths, of course, was more spiritually directed in actions of thanksgiving to God, and it revolved around the temple there in Jerusalem. But that same festive spirit, I have an idea, was experienced that you would know of or think about in this festival here in Valdez. The planning and the celebration aspects must have gone into getting oneself to Jerusalem to experience it. We experience some of that expectancy in this passage as it is expressed by the brothers of Jesus. And that's the point where we need to look back at the first part of chapter 7 and get a little bit more context for what's happening here. I'm going to read from the first part of chapter 7. It says that after this, Jesus went about Galilee, way up north from Jerusalem. He did not wish to go about in Judea because the Jews were looking for an opportunity to kill him. Now the Jewish festival of Booths was near. So his brothers said to him, "Leave here and go to Judea so that your disciples may see the works that you're doing. For no one who wants to be widely known acts in secret. If you do these things, show yourself to the world." And John, the writer, adds parenthetically, "For not even his brothers believed in him." The brothers were saying, "Look, you can stay here in Galilee and be a small fish in a little pond, or you can go to Jerusalem and make a bigger splash, be a big fish in a bigger pond." Jesus replies to them, "No, a time has not yet come. You go on to the festival. I am not going." After saying this, he remained in Galilee. But at verse 10, John records that Jesus decided to go to the festival. but he tried to keep out of range of his brothers, wanting to maintain secrecy. Then, at verse 14, we see the veil of secrecy being thrown off. It says, verse 14, about the middle of the festival, Jesus went up into the temple and began to teach. The Jews were astonished at it, saying, how does this man have such learning when he's never been taught? And in the subsequent verses, we see a lot of back and forth questioning, Jesus forcefully teaching, Jewish leaders and people in the crowd expressing accusations on the one hand, and others saying, but wait, this could be the Messiah. In verse 32, we read where the Pharisees had heard enough, and they wanted to arrest him. So we come to this verse 37. On the last day of the festival, the great day, it went on for several days, you see, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. And John comments after that, saying, now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for yet as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. John doesn't mean there that the Holy Spirit hadn't been around forever. He's just meaning that Jesus' glorification is going to be the event. And John is revealing that he's writing at a time well beyond that first Pentecost in Acts. He does not want to confuse the issue by referring to the Acts event here. He stays on track with what Jesus said about the Spirit at a time leading up to his arrest. John wants the crucifixion and the resurrection to remain the focal point moment, the glorifying moment, when the Spirit of God moves so powerfully to begin making believers. One thing to note here, might we possibly discover what Old Testament scripture Jesus is referring to when he said, as the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. You can look that passage up by cross-referencing it. And the passage in question seems to be found in Isaiah 12, 2 through 4, which we used as our call to worship words earlier today. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known his deeds among the nations. Proclaim that his name is exalted. Jesus' reference of water, water that's welling up from a well as a metaphor for salvation in this story, would have special meaning to the people there participating at the Feast of Booths, because it's understood that during the Feast of Booths, every day that it was going on, it was the custom that the priests would draw water from the pool of Siloam, one of the holy places there in Jerusalem. And that water would be taken in golden flasks to the temple altar and poured out on the altar as an act of thanksgiving. So here, Jesus may have been making a comparison with this custom. The inference for any who would believe in him that he himself become not still water from a placid pool, but the flowing water of a spirit-filled faith in him. passage from Isaiah 12 is but one of several in the Old Testament in which water is the symbol for the moving, flowing Holy Spirit, always present from the time of creation itself, and to be even more visible in the Lord's glorification. And one other place that we might note here, if you go back to the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John, there's another place where the incident of the Samaritan woman at the well, and when Jesus told her, if you knew who it is that's asking you for a drink of water, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. So the gospel writer John follows up these words of Jesus with his own explanation. He said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus had not yet been glorified. John is doing theology here. He's doing his own take on the theology of the Holy Spirit. John is a disciple who walked with Jesus. And scholars think that he was writing this around 85 AD, putting together an account of all that he remembered about what had happened with Jesus in those years before his crucifixion and resurrection. As we've mentioned, he doesn't go into the story of Pentecost. He was one of the apostles. If he was somewhat closeted away there in Jerusalem after Jesus had left them, why does he not mention this Pentecost event in his gospel? He wanted to report the days of Jesus' earthly presence, wanted to build a theology closely tied to the person of Jesus. And yet this verse 39 does point to the gift of the Spirit in the understanding that the Holy Spirit is present in the life of the believer. The convicting influence in one's life, the converting influence. So how do we know if we have the Spirit? We know at the moment faith becomes for us a personal thing. Quiet conviction deep in our being that says, yes, I believe this. I believe Jesus is the Christ of God. I'm willing to stand and confess it to the church and be baptized in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I want to build my life on this confession. I know I'll probably not be able to follow Jesus perfectly, and I'll always be dependent on his grace. But this is who I am. And I'm not going to be shy about saying so. When you're finally able to feel that way and say it, according to this passage in the words of Jesus, we have the Spirit. And it's like abundant water pouring and splashing into our thirsty souls. In closing, a challenge and a caution. As active participants of the church, we Presbyterians often do not speak of the Spirit for some reason. I don't know. Maybe it goes back to our Calvinist roots. But you know, we don't need to be reticent about sharing conversation about the work of the Spirit of God. And neither is it necessary to speak of it to the extent that would drive people away, claiming to have some experience that you haven't had, making people feel guilty. That's not what it's about. At the beginning of this message, I posed a question about what motivates us to keep showing up for church or to do something in the name of God for the church. Actually, we don't have to try to answer that question with spiritual speech or language. We can just shine the countenance of people who are joyful in Christ. Just live it. Live it in faithful presence and love God's people. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us affirm this faith that we share by standing and saying together the Apostles' Creed. Let us say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. God has poured out his Spirit upon us, and so we come to respond as an action of our worship and the giving of our tithes and offerings. Let us worship. Gracious, giving God, you have poured out your gifts upon us. You have blessed us beyond measure. We come seeking to participate in the act of giving. We might extend grace through our own lives, the the grace that you give us. So bless these offerings and bless us as we stand before you, that we might give more of our lives in thanksgiving. In the name of Christ Jesus.